Hello everybody. As you may already have read, I would like to do future videos as a live stream. The live stream takes place in German language because I'm far away from live streams in English language. The re-uploaded video will be in German language and English language. If you like to know why I'm doing this channel especially, you can read it under discussion on my YouTube channel. Hey, already one like. I'm hopefully gonna install Git and Pi-hole server on a Raspberry Pi. I think you all know these little things. I need these two little slaves in my local area network. I use Git for a lot of things, coding, presentation, text files, project descriptions, small binary files, all kind of stuff. Git here is a lightweight open source Git clone. It's a fork from GOX, I think, in 2016 about. You can read about the differences between Git, GOG, and the other Git servers on various sites on the internet. The configuration needed around GitDE can be very painful, and I did it once, I think, about 3-4 years ago, I don't know. And GitDE is really easy to install. It's a binary file, yeah. You can compile it from Go, but I won't do that on a Raspberry Pi. You only have to copy the binary file, but I will use Nginx and MariaDB to keep the impact on the Raspberry Pi as small as possible, yeah. But when we're done with GitDE, we take a closer look at Pi-hole and install it as well on the Raspberry Pi 3B. But first, let's take a quick look at the Pi that I'm using for this project. Okay, every good board starts with a good power supply. And you didn't gain much with a good power supply, but you can lose all with a bad power supply. The power supply on this board, Raspberry Pi 3B, is really well designed and guarantees a wide range of input, like LiPos or USB. The components I used are good quality. And I recommend to not buy stuff from China, clones or such this. It's really worth the money. The main chip on the power supply is this one here. Let's take a closer look at it. I think you can read it. It's a 2306 step-down DC to DC converter, a switched mode power supply, with a lot of features like soft start, under voltage lockout, and much more. It provides two channels with a maximum current drain of about 1 amp. I think this is per channel. And the voltages, you can see the KA here after the 2306. The K stands for 3.3 volts and the E stands for 1.8 volt. Whenever switch power supply is used, we need two things, capacitor and an inductor. Say 4R7 means the inductor, that's 4.7 microhenry and some caps. Also we need some diodes, especially Zener diodes for, you know, to prevent magic smoke. Okay, so let's take a look at the Broadcom chip. Yeah, this is the BCM2837B, I think. No, this is the 2837. The BCM2837B0 is used on the newer 3A and 3B Plus models. But think about it a minute. This is a 64-bit, 1.2 GHz quad-core ARM chip. Yeah, that's amazing on this little board. Think back 5 years. Really good. It will host Pi-hole and GitDE without any problems. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. Okay, so another chip. This is the LAN chip from SMC, the LAN 9514. Whenever you do things with the LAN, especially on the 3B Plus with the 1 gigabit LAN, don't forget this chip is USB. Yeah, it's an Ethernet over USB chip. And if you use 1 gigabit LAN, you will, well, that will be a very great impact on the USB side. The only thing on the backside interesting is the 1 gigabit RAM chip. I think it's a DDR2 memory, when I remember this correct. Yeah, there are lots of Raspberry Pi tier-tons out there, so let's get started with the installation of Raspbian OS. You can find it on the Raspberry Pi org downloads site. Raspbian, and we go with Raspbian Stretch Lite. I want to keep the impact from the software on the Raspberry Pi as small as possible. Okay, so let's download it and we get the ISO image. You can burn this ISO image with any program you like. I like Rufus. It's easy and lightweight. Okay, let's unzip it to. It'll be only a few seconds. Yeah, there it is. Okay, so here comes Rufus. We choose the image file that on the correct, that's really, I think it should be there. I should. F drive is the card reader. Okay, so let's start. Oh. Okay. So let's start the Raspberry Pi. Have to use this wristband because this chair is really dangerous for electronic components. Okay, so simply plug it in and start your Raspberry. Maybe I have to restart . Nope, it works, I think. Yeah, that looks good. Okay, let's place it again here. Yeah, never mind the chat. My plan was to do a live stream today, but OBS Studio version 23 is really messed up. So there was no chance to take a live stream. I use an Ethernet, an USB stick to Bluetooth. That works very well. Yeah, there it is. First login is always Pi and Raspberry. You may notice I won't accept the password. That's because I use a German keyboard layout. So I have to trick a bit. First thing I do is change the keyboard layout. This one was, didn't remember. There it is. think it is keyboard. Yeah, this keyboard. Mostly I use Nano, I don't know why. Okay, here it is, Great Britain. Let's make Germany keyboard layout. And let's update. Should be here. Let's get the updates and then restart it so the German keyboard layout will take place. Yeah, the undervoltage is a bit of a problem. I use a 5-volt charger. I will shut it down thereafter and use a 5-volt plug-in for the Raspberry Pi specialized. Okay, 112 megabytes. Shouldn't take long. The voltage should be gone by now, and the German keyboard layout should be working. Should. Yeah. Okay, it's okay. Under voltage detection. I think I have another one. Okay, so let's start with GTEA. First thing we have to do is to add a user. Whenever I type comments, I will do it one comment per line, not 20 comments in one line. So you can see everything. Okay, whenever I install something, the first time on a Linux machine, I use very easy passwords like password 123. That's only for the time of the installation. Thereafter, I'm gonna log in via a secure shell, use a password manager, and exchange these passwords to very long passwords even I don't remember. Okay, so let's say user git. Git 123. Never use such passwords on a production machine. Nope, nope. Yes, this is correct. Okay. If you have created a user and need to change the password, you can do this with sudo passwd and git. Then you can enter the new Unix password. 123. Okay, then we need to add our new Git user to the sudo group via user mod. Dash A means append, dash G means group. Missing the command itself. User mode. Okay, next thing we have to do is to install the components we need. This is Git, MySQL, and Nginx. You can buy specialized power supplies for the Raspbian with a switch on it. Somewhere here I should have one, but I have no idea where exactly. Maybe I take a look in the meanwhile. So now this problem should be gone. Okay, and let's continue with the MySQL secure installation after the boot. I think it's installation. Yeah. Current password for root. We have no password for root in the MySQL database for now. So we hit enter. And yes, we want to set the root data, the root password. And always, always, always write passwords down as soon as you type it in. Remove anonymous users, yes. Disallow root login remotely, no, yes. Remove test database, yes. Reload privileged tables now, yes, if you like. Okay, so this is the basic setup for MySQL. Now we need to create the database. We log in with the user root. Okay, no idea why that. The current password for use, enter. I think it haven't accept our password. Okay, let's try this again. Sudo, I don't think so. Well, yes, it has to be sudo to login. Okay, now we're inside the database and let's create our first database. We call it Gitea. Always write it down. Sorry for this. speaking. Next, we have to create a user for this database. We create the user Gitea at localhost. And we set identified by new password. Say Gitea 123. Create user Gitea at localhost. Identified by Gitea 123. Okay, query okay. Then we grant all privileges. On Gitea on this database. And we grant this to Gitea at localhost. So we can log in with the user Gitea and can do everything we like inside this database. Then we flush the privileges. Okay, let's take a look. Port, just an idea where this works. If an SQL syntax show global variable like port should be working. Maybe it's port. Nope. Show global. I think it's variables. There is an S missing. Okay. So we know our MySQL database listens on port 3306. This is the standard. Okay, and sometimes the identified by tag didn't work. That causes a lot of trouble. So what I do is I set the password again. And write it down. Can't find any machine ruin user table. That's interesting. Ah. Better. Okay, that's it. Okay, I always use easy passwords, told you so, in the installation process, because I want to make sure that there are no problems with character encoding. Yeah, I use a German keypad, and you can imagine when you type special characters as root password, that's get really messed up sometimes. So I will change these passwords later via the SSH shell. Good. We are now done with the, we have created the table. So next thing is we have to install Git on the Raspberry Pi. Okay, let's change to our user Git. We are already in the home directory. There's enough space. Okay. Let's make a directory. Call it Gitea. Xperia Bash Read. Yeah. Good. Okay, now we need to get the GTR binary file. I use wget, wget, and then I keep. Let's change to this here. We are looking for the binary file. And you can download it. There it is. There it is. GTR. Here you have all kinds of versions. We go with the latest, the 1.7.3. And maybe there you have a problem to choose what kind of processor you have, an ARM5, an ARM6, an ARM7. Let's switch back to Raspberry Pi. There's an easy way to determine that is LSCPU. And you see there's an ARM7-1. Little endians, 4 cores, 1 core at 1.2 GHz, minimum at 600 MHz. So we go with the version 7. Okay, if you have already a SSH shell, you can copy the path directly or you type it in. That's what I do. Works. And as easy as upgrading, yeah? Just replace the binary file with the new one, done. That's upgrading it here. There it is. Okay, let's rename it to GTR. And what I always do is I create a file where I store the version and the installation date. Today is the 11th? Yeah, the 11th. 11th of March. 1.7.3 GTR version history. Okay, so you see this file. You always have the version inside it. And I append a new version when I upgrade it. Okay, next we need to execute it. Let's check. Yeah, that looks good. Okay, next thing we have to do is we want to run GTR on startup automatically. And that's very easy with the init process, but we have to specify some things. First, we need three things running before GTR. That's syslog, that's network, and that's the database. And maybe the name they use for this is a bit different on your distribution or your machine. If it is Raspbian, you can simply copy the code, but maybe you have to find it. So we use systemctl, list units. Type, let's search for services, okay? I think just missing a dash. Yeah, that's it. Okay, let's start with services. Okay, let's take a closer look with Xeron, dbus, DHCP, Getty, keyboard, keymode. There is mariadb.service. Let's write that down. Networking service. Okay, and our syslog service. Let's see, we got some targets. Basic crypt setter, categorical multi user, network.target. and our syslog service. Okay, show you in a minute. How this works. You can always search via grep. List units /// all grep MariaDB. Then you see MariaDB is a service. We need network. Then you see we got networking service, but we got network target. We use the target in this case. And we need this syslog. We got syslog.socket. We don't need that, but we need the rsyslog service. Okay, so let's create a startup service for GTEA. etc systemd system and GTEA service. Okay, let's create the startup script. First is the unit. The unit section is configuring relationships and some metadata. Perhaps description, we use GTEA, always use short, pregnant terms. Description. Then we got some after. After means this service needs run before. So GTEA starts after this services we specify, and that is the network target, as we found. And the syslog, it's rsyslog service. And after MariaDB. DP service or target service. Okay. Next thing, the service tab. The service section of the file is the configuration section for our service. We tell systemd how to manage the service itself. And first thing we do is we specify, in case of a crash, restart it. Restart is per default always no, so the system the process crashes and systemd won't restart it. But yes, we want to restart it always when it's crashing. We can specify seconds. The default is, I think, 200 milliseconds. It's a very short time, so I give them 5 seconds to get things ready. Type, when possible, always use simple. Don't want to get into details, but it's systemd how to manage the service. Next thing is the user. User needs to be git. Group. The group needs to be git for this service. And the working directory. Working directory is home git GTEA. Then the start exec start is home git GTEA git with web thereafter. Environment user git specifies a variable. Then the home directory is home and git. Yeah. Let's think. If I forgot something. Got the description after syslog network and MariaDB. Maybe it's MySQL service for you. Then with the service tab, restart always, restart seconds 5, type simple, user git groups in working directory specified, exec star, start is specified, t missing, git gtr web and room and user git home, home git, okay. That looks good. Next thing we have to do is the install tab. The install section tells the system how the unit is enabled. There is the alias section here and wanted by or once. There are multiple things you can do here. We have only one wanted by multi-user target. Okay, let's try to enable the service. Systemctl enable gtr service. Okay. If no installation configuration wanted by required by LSL setting installation signal default instance for template use. Take a look again. Description after network targets after. Okay, there is a wanted by multi-user target. Maybe this causes the problem. Yeah, that's it. Okay. Just a little camel case problem. Okay, now we have enabled our service. Let's try to start it. Now it should be running. Let's check it with Sean.ctl. Okay, let's take a look. Yep, started gtr. Failed with result execute main process exited gtr service and entered failed state. Okay, let's see. Nope, it's not running. Unknown value home in section service. Okay. Well, it isn't running, so it should be no problem to edit it. Home. Home. Home git. That should be working. Okay, you see the it tries to start every 5 seconds. That's exactly what we told them, so it is not completely messed up. Exhaust unit entered fail state, okay. Nope, still not running. Okay, let's check it again. Unit description is gtr after network target, after rsyslog service, after MariaDB service, service tab. Restart. Always. Start seconds. 5 seconds. Well, that works. Type is simple. User is git. Our group is git. Working directory is home git gtr. Exec start is home git gtr git web. Ah, there it is. It's gtr web. Okay, so. Restart it again. Or start the gtr service. There it is. Okay, now the process is up and running. Let's check the journal. Yep. That looks better. Okay, so now we've got the service up and running. So if we reboot the computer, it will start automatically again. Okay, next thing we have to do is to set up Nginx. Let's see if it is running. Typo. PS aux grep Nginx. Okay, that looks good. We have the process itself. It runs under root. And we got four worker processes. You can specify this in the Nginx conf file. For each core, one worker process. That looks exactly as it is, should be. Okay, now we tell Nginx that we have a Getir server running. Nginx have two directories for this purpose, sites available and sites enable. Sites available is the working directory for us, where we put our configuration for the Getir website. And thereafter, we create a symlink to sites enabled. If you delete this symlink in site enabled, the configuration still is intact, but it's not enabled. I recommend you to stick to this symlinks and procedures, because if you start to copy and move files, things will get really confusing. Okay, so just let's change your directory so I can show you this. Nginx should be there. Okay, here is sites available and sites enabled. Go into sites available. There is our default. You can see this is just a small config file. It listens on the 80 port for IP version 4 and version 6. And that's it, nothing special. We keep it as it is. What we do is inside this directory, we create another one. And we call it Getir. Okay. Nginx is the configuration files are very easy. So at first, we need a server. This server listens on port 80 for IP version 4. I don't need anything else because I only have IP version 4 in my network, but if you need to configure for IPv6, it's like that. Okay. Then we specify the server name. It's an underscore. Server name Getir. Very easy. Always put the semicolon to the end. Then we specify the location for this. And the max body size. Oop, 100 megabyte. That's because I use binary files on my Git server too. So maybe Nginx has to provide and pass through great files. Okay, and should listen on localhost port 3000. So well, that's it. Let's see, listen 80, semicolon, listen 80 for IP version 6, server name is Getir, we specify the location, client max body size, I think the default is, I don't know, some K I think, proxy pass, HTTP localhost, 1000, okay, that looks good. And now we check for errors. That's not very difficult. Nginx do this on his own. Syntax is okay. And yeah, configuration file is okay. Okay, next thing we do is we want a symlink to get this Gitea to the enable site. Always use full paths when you use symlink. Sites available Gitea to etc nginx sites enabled Gitea. That's it. Then sudo systemctl reload nginx. And that should do the work. Okay, let's take a fast look at the configuration file. Worker connections, multi accept on, basic setting send file, TCP, keep alive. Okay, this user here that is here specified is nginx runs under root privileges, and the worker processes uses this www data. Worker processes auto, you can specify such 2 or 4 if you like, and include models enabled. Okay, not much there. Okay, that looks good. Okay, so let's check if we already can log into the browser. First, we need to know our IP address. Okay, I recommend you to specify a static IP address, not a dynamic one, or as I runs here, I have a Fritzbox, and the Fritzbox always gives the same IP address to the Raspberry Pi. This is really necessary for Pi-hole. So we get later to this. So we got the 26. Welcome to Nginx. Here it is. Let's see, port 3000. There it is, Gitea. That's it. Done. Okay, so we need to set up a few things here first. And the first thing you have to do is to register a user. You see here, initial configuration. So this first user is your admin. Okay, database, MySQL is correct. Host address, username and password. Password, we use the 123, database name is Gitea. Site title, Gitea with a couple of T, should be okay, it's okay, server domain okay. Okay, there are two things you should change. First is the domain. Because we will see that later, if you clone a project or such thing, you always have localhost in this path. And if you put your IP address inside this, you don't have to type the IP address every time you clone something. Okay, do this for the domain and the application URL. Okay, let's check again, the port is correct. We check this inside the SQL database. Gitea password is correct, database name is correct. password is correct, generation git here, home git git here, repositories is okay, home git git here, data is okay, run as username git is okay, server domain is the server port, here listen port 3000 is okay, base URL is okay, and logged path is okay. Well, that should do the job. Okay, let's switch to the Raspberry Pi. Okay, there it is. Okay, next thing to do, we register a user. Specify any email address you like. Register the account, yeah. And that's it. From now on, you have a fully operational Git server on your Raspberry Pi. Okay, I need to drink some water. I'll be back soon.
So welcome back. Okay, the next thing we do is we're gonna install Pi-hole on this Raspberry Pi, where Gitea works fine for now. What is Pi-hole? Pi-hole is a network-wide deblocking solution on a DNS-based level. That means you can specify it as DNS server and it filters ads everywhere on your mobile devices, in your apps. It simply blocks all access to the ads. You may ask, why Pi-hole? Why should I block ads? I mean, as they are money. Well, yeah, they are money, but they are simply annoying. And not only annoying, they are spying on you and they are dangerous and they can harm your computer. And they do this in a very regular way. Okay, how this works? Let's see, at first there's your browser, yeah? Chrome here as an example. Let's say Chrome. You can do amazing stuff with it, watching videos, pictures, listen to music. You can use it to work on documents via Google Docs or Microsoft Office. There are so many ways you can use your browser. That means a browser is an operating system inside an operating system. It is a really huge construction, a really huge construction. And also it is a very insecure construction. There are tons of bugs for the browser you use exactly at this moment for every one of them, yeah, not even for Chrome, for Internet Explorer, Mozilla, all of them. Okay, that isn't enough. Yeah, we have a browser that can do everything and is insecure. That sounds bad, but we need a criminal mind. Okay, let's see, he's buying a web server, spent a few bucks, didn't need much. It's very easy. We did it with Nginx on the Raspberry Pi a few minutes ago. Then he copies ransomware onto the server. Let's say WannaCry executable, the WannaCry executable. Finally, he creates an advertisement banner. Now we have a browser and we have a server with ransomware on it, let's say WannaCry. Finally, he creates an advertisement banner who says, buy this dog food, it's best. Yeah? But some of the code that he uses in this banner is malicious. It let the dog food banner connect to his server to the ransomware. And this is nothing unusual, yeah? If you think this, oh my god, what is this thing doing? No, that's completely normal, yeah? Ads often connect to somewhere on this planet and transfer all the data they can find on your device, on your PC, on your mobile phone, to the servers for analytics. It's called third party, and that is how they make money. Then the bad guy uploads the advertisement banner to his preferred ID network and specifies exactly who should see the banner. Everyone who needs his computer is perfect for him. Okay, so let's say we target Twitch streamers, 20 to 40 years with an income of more than $2,000, who uses Firefox because, let's say, the code uses a critical bug inside Firefox. Well, I'm safe. I use Chrome for the moment. And you can specify really creepy things there, like ethnics, income, sexual addiction, political orientation, and much, much more. You can try this out yourself on Facebook if you like. Okay, so what happens next? Well, you sit on your computer, go to your local newspaper, or let's say Yahoo. And you see a shiny little dog food banner. Where is it? You see this little dog food banner somewhere, and maybe you don't even notice it at all. Your PC gets slower and slower, and then next thing you see, that beauty. Oops, file's encrypted. What happened? Okay, the blinky banner connected to the server of the bad man. Yeah? And the WannaCry executable transferred to your browser uses a bug so it can start this executable on your device, on your computer, on your PC. And it encrypted it. Well, you may think, oh, that's odd. What happened to me? Well, it happened, and it happens a lot. It happens at MSN, Yahoo, Let's Encrypt, Pirate Bay. All kinds of sites have already delivered ransomware via ads and third party directly to their user. You can search for it. Let's try malverticing MSN. Ha! There it is. MSN, Yahoo. There it is. This beauty. Well, that's a picture designed from Scott Brinker, Chief Martech, and Annette Baker. And this here are all companies who works with ads. The hacker upload its shiny banner there, yeah, let's say, okay? You can do nothing against it, yeah? And never trust them. These ID companies, they will say, yeah, it's safe, it's secure, we check the code, we know, we do our best, yeah. Don't you ever trust them, yeah. What you do earn from 1,000 clicks, nothing, yeah, that's penny stock. So do they, yeah. 50% of your income gets there in this picture that's all here. And 50% is for you. So there is nothing, yeah, there are cents, pennies that don't matter, yeah. They only need clicks, millions of them. And 99.9% of these companies will never check any code because that requires a lot of time and manpower. And the people who check the code from thousands of different developers has to be really smart to find malicious parts. They must be good, and good means they are very, very pricey. And even if they did, hey, the Batman says, oh, you've messed it up. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, okay, I tried here. 5 minutes later, nobody cares. Next, most of these companies have their corporate headquarters somewhere on this planet. What do you want to do? Lawsuit them? Forget it. You have the financial damage. They don't care. Okay. So what can you do? That's very difficult because more and more users are aware of this problem. Yeah, they find it annoying. And when they find out that ads are dangerous, they block it. Yeah, and picture each. These are the monthly active users who uses ID blockers, and that goes up. That means as that goes up, your profit with ads will go down. So you have to look for other possibilities to promote and monetize your hobby, because ID blocking is increasing fast. As advertising will reduce over time, the market will arise new opportunities, but for now, it is not easy. You can use Amazon Wishlist, Subscribestar, PayPal, SEPA Transaction, Mines, Mastodon, Diaspora. I personally wouldn't use Patreon because they take down accounts for political reasons and destroys the income of these people with one click. And there are very few possibilities. You need it for the moment. There are first impacts on the internet companies. Spotify announced they will ban people who use ID blockers. Well, okay, I deleted my account and moved away from Spotify's, yeah. By the way, you can use every file format, even audio files, to deliver malicious code. Yeah, that didn't matter. Okay, so much about why I'm blocking ads. Because they are annoying, they are spying on my life and my data, and they are dangerous. And nothing will convince me to go back to a world without AD blocking. Never ever. So let's install Pi-hole on the Raspberry Pi. Okay. First we need to install Pi-hole. That is a first we need to install such things around Pi-hole. Nginx is already on our server, but now we need PHP. We go with the 7.0 FPM, then PHP 7.0 zip, and we need the Apache 2 utils. Okay, let's see. If you like, you can use a second console for work. So I didn't want to log in as root. Okay, that's because I already created some I already created a config file for Pi. I'll show you in a moment where you can get this one. Okay, yeah, there it is. Let's switch back with Alt F1. Okay, installation process is over. Next thing we need to do is we need to install Pi-hole. That's very easy with curl. Okay, is it here? Yep, it is here. https://install.py/ho.net and use the bash. Okay. And that will do the work. Pi-hole is really easy to manage and to update. With sudo pi-hole up, you can upgrade your server. Okay, that's correct. Okay, I use a secure quad 9. The standard host lists, let's do that. Let's block IP44 and IP version 6. Kubernetes and a static address. Yes, we want to use them. I told my router to not give any other address to it. The web admin interface, yes. The web server, no. You want to log queries? Yep. Exactly. Okay. First, we keep that on show everything. But in case of security, be aware that if you show everything,
PyHole will log every single DNS query from your iPhone, from your Android smartphone, from your PC. They will log everything, yeah? So you're really transparent if you keep this. I recommend try it, configure it, and when it is running, disable the statistics completely. Well, okay, in the meanwhile, we can copy the default page to our Nginx. When you remember, we have under sites available, we have our default site. And we replace it with another default site. I will put the link in the description of the video where you can find this. Of course, it's a really long to type it into. It's called default and we copy it. Yeah. Okay, as you can see now, there is a bit more. We have our listen 80 ports and PHP files and JavaScript files. And we already have a rudimentary HT password file. Okay, that's good. Okay. Okay, your admin web page, login. Write it down. Okay, so let's try to log in. It was 26. Welcome to Nginx. Okay, that sees. Okay, now restart. Okay, let's restart it and try again. Yeah, now you see we need to sign in, but we didn't have any sign in. So what to do? Well, let's get back to Raspberry Pi. And first we need to create a username. Let's do it with shell c echo n. Let's call it Frank. Or camel. Why not? Okay, and let's write it to etc nginx ht pass vd. Okay, let's check it sudo c echo n camel. Yeah, misses. Slash is missing. Okay, let's try this. That looks good. Okay, now we have the entry camel. Next thing we have to do is to create a password for camel. We can do this with OpenSSL. Again. OpenSSL password, we need to specify APR1 to get the correct format. And again, to Nginx
ht passwd. Okay, let's check the command. Sudo shell c openssl password ap. You can April is a good hint. Okay. Okay, let's specify a password for camel. Write it down. Okay, let's take a look. There it is. Camel and our password. Okay, so we have the password set. Let's search for with sudo pi-hole up, you can pi-hole will check everything and look if it's up to date. It even tells you if PHP is outdated. Okay. Okay, I think I don't like the standard password, so I set a new password. You can set the new password in Hi-Hold with dash a dash p and enter new password. Okay. So that's it. Now let's check a few things. And first thing is the ownership of the HTML directory to the Nginx user. Let's do it anyway. www.data. Wdata, yeah, that's okay. Var www.html. Okay, next thing is make sure it is writable. 755. HTML, and the next thing is to start the PHP 7.0-fpm start, I think it is. Nope. Yeah, it is. Okay, but it's, as always, needs to be started as sudo. Okay, and then let's restart Nginx. Let's restart the Nginx again with sudo. Okay, so that should it be. So let's try it again. Give our username. Yeah. And here it is. This login here, this is the password we specified via the pi-hole command. Okay, and here it is, our pi-hole server up and running. Now on 192.3.8.4, but I have, you can import and export as you like. Okay, let's choose my teleporter file and let's import it. There are, I think, 1.1 million block domains on this list and a few whitelisting. Okay, all you have to do now is to specify the IP address of your Raspberry as a DNS server. Let's do this. Should be the one. Under internet, I think account information. Yeah, there it is, DNS server. Now we specify our new DNS server here. It's 26, I think. That's okay, didn't care. quad 9 as alternative if this one doesn't work. You can use 9 or 10. 10 means 10 is a unfiltered DNS server, but you won't get DNSSEC over it. Okay, so that's it. Let's take a look. I think the file is simply too big. Okay, next thing to do, let's shut it down. And take a look if all processes start. So much for Kitea and Pi-hole on a Raspberry Pi. Okay, I see Nginx, I see Kitea, I see Pi-hole FTL. That looks as expected. Okay, I imported it in. Yep, that's okay. Okay, let's take a look at the lists now. Pi-hole now checking every list online and imported thousands of thousands of thousands blacklist entries. As you expect, that will take a while. Yeah, as you see, it timed out again. So I have to import them manually. Okay. Whenever you have problems with the Raspberry, with Pi-hole, with dash R parameter, you can repair it to the scratch. And I don't remember any problem that couldn't solve by this command. Again, and there it is, 1.6 million block domains. Let's try it, and you are gone. This site can't be reached. Well, that's it. Every single device you have inside this network uses now this DNS server, and it's blocked everywhere. So that's it for today. Good night, and have fun.